kar začeli, čeprav še ni naša akademska četrt. Bom kratko predstavitev naredila v angleščini našega gosta, tako da tudi on razume. It's my pleasure today that I can introduce to you our speaker, who will speak about the problem of jellyfish in Japan, but it's not a problem limited to their area, it's in many places worldwide. That's why we were very happy that within a bilateral project between Japan and Slovenia, we can host Professor Shin Ichiuye and also his students here. Professor Uye did his bachelor and master degree at Hiroshima University, where he is now full professor. During his master studies, he spent 1 year as a master student of world-known Scripps Institute of Oceanography in San Diego, in California, and then returned to Japan to complete masters at, as I said, Hiroshima University, but he continued with his PhD study at Tohoku University. He completed his doctoral thesis in 1981, and his topic was zooplankton, which is tiny marine animals suspended in the water column that are important, although many people don't see them, but they are important for marine food web, including their role as a fish food. During his zooplankton study, he realized about the impact of jellyfish on the zooplankton, so gradually his focus switched to jellyfish, and since then he and his colleagues advanced greatly understanding of life cycle, reproductive biology of many different aspects of jellyfish ecology. Professor Uye served as vice president of Hiroshima University and also had different roles in associations, like he was president of Japanese Association for Plantology, and he was also chairing and president of World Association of Copepodologists. His research work was prized by awards. He received several awards, national awards, from Society of Oceanography in 83, 99, I think,
yes,
and two times, yeah. And one more in 90.
I forgot.
I should have taken my list where I put all this. And most recently, he was awarded a national medal. He received this medal from hands of Japanese Prime Minister Noda just in June, this June.
Last month.
Shin was also organizing many international conferences, serving as a member of committee, chairperson, has led many research projects, but it would take too long time to make a list. So, Shin, floor is yours.
Thank you, Alenka. I'm very happy to be here to present my current interest. Big plankton, huge plankton. You may know that plankton is small organism suspended in the ocean. However, my plankton, particularly, I will just talk, a part of my presentation is the giant jellyfish. You will see how large they are. Well, of course, the jellyfish is worldwide, everywhere. However, the increase of the jellyfish now occurring worldwide, it becomes more serious problem than before. My research area, my seat is, since I'm from Japan, East Asian Sea. East Asian Sea consists of Bohai, yellow, East China, and Japan seeds. This is a sort of enclosed seed or marginal seeds. This area is very small compared to huge ocean area, but fish catch account for 11% of the world of fish catch. So, meaning this area is very productive. However, that we have huge number of human population, and then causing some environmental impact. So this area is one of the hotspots of the environment. Global warming is remarkable. Eutrophication, harmful algal blooms are also remarkable. Also, the atmospheric environmental problems such as photochemical smog and yellow dust. In the sea, actually, we have, of course, the jellyfish root worm. What's the situation in these East Asian seas? Actually, two jellyfish species has a problem. Of course, there's many, quite other, not many, several species cause problem, particularly these two species. One is Aurelia alita. This slide shows the white carpet-like aggregation in the inlet, because of the slightly darker image projected here, you cannot see very clearly, but they form a huge aggregation area, which happened for the first time in 2000 in the inland sea of Japan. And also, we have a problem with giant jellyfish. I will show you later how large this jellyfish is, but they get aggregated and then cause severe problem to fishing net. So I will first describe the problem by Aurelia alita, which is more common to many people. I'm from Hiroshima here. The sea is, we call the inland sea of Japan. Mediterranean Sea is the world's largest inland sea. However, ours are just a miniature of the Mediterranean Sea, but very productive sea and causing a lot of problem here. You see, some fish catch is full of jellyfish. You'll find small number of fish here in this net. However, we do not know when this jellyfish become more abundant. We have no scientific proof. So we went to the fishing village and then interviewed the fishermen. When these jellyfish become more abundant? Of course, depending on their experience, they can tell something to us. And then we constructed a sort of relative increase of this jellyfish population. They increase, particularly recent 15 to 10 years, recent 15 to 10 years, that is the 1990s, this species become more abundant than before. You know that the jellyfish have two major life stages. This slide shows the life cycle of jellyfish. Medusa, which you'll see, if you go to the sea, you will just see this medusa. Medusa are male and female, and then fertilize the eggs. And then eggs hatch into larvae called plana. Okay, and then planula goes down to the seawater and then attached to a hard substrate and change the form into polyp. And polyp, asexual, no sex, asexually reproduce to increase their numbers. And then at a certain time, they get stovulated. Stovulated means the polyp get elongated, the body, and then segmented into many layers. And then this stovulated polyp reveals a baby jellyfish. And then this ephyra grows gradually to adult medusa. This is the life cycle. And you may know how important the polyp stage are to determine the population size of the medusa, which caused the problem. What's the environmental factors may accelerate the reproduction of polyp? One is food supply. So eutrophication is apparently one of the causes. And also temperature increase associated with the increase of the polyp numbers. So global warming is another factor. Okay. What's the major food for polyp? Polyp is very tiny, several millimeters, okay? And then spread the tentacles to catch the food. Their major food is not the big corpuscles. Tiny cilia are very important. You will see these larger, the cilia. These are important food for them. And then once the water gets eutrophicated, their numbers become more, their number become more increased. So eutrophication is a partly stimulate the increase of the ciliates, which is important food for polyp. So eutrophication is partly the one driver. And also, one of the characteristic things for the polyp is attach the underside, under surface of the, some artificial structure, such as floating pier, okay? Just like this. And then we have a new floating pier installed. That is the April 2010, and then after this, we just kept monitoring the polyp. Of course, in the beginning, no polyp, okay? Since the floating pier is new, and then the polyp attached, and then increased their numbers. And then they gradually decreased the number, but during winter, they get strobilated. Strobilated is making many layers to prepare for the release of their fiber. And then actually they release the fiber, lots of the fiber. The size of the floating pier is just 6 meters wide and 48 meters length. Okay? So this floating pier just produced nearly 20 million ephyra. So I say that the increase of the artificial structure is one of the drivers to make the jellyfish more serious conditions. What happens to the fish? Fish we selectively catch, remove by fisheries, okay? Actually, the inland sea of Japan is very productive. So I should say that the fish-dominated ecosystem is formed many years before. So we have quite a high fishing catch, annual fishing catch. However, in recent years, you will see the steadily decreasing of the fish catch. And then we have more problem of the jellyfish. So, warming, the eutrophication, marine construction, overfishing cause to jellyfish dominated ecosystem. Once we have lots of fish, now we have lots of jellyfish, but small amount of fish stock. Also, we have a negative impact to other industries, other sectors. That is the coastal power plant. This case is not the inland sea of Japan. This is just facing the sea of Japan. Kashiwazaki Kariwa, the nuclear power station, which is the largest power station in Japan. To make the electricity, they need a huge amount of seawater for cooling. Okay? Of course, if they take the amount of huge amount of seawater, the jellyfish or plankton just automatically sucked up into the plant. So sometimes the huge amount of jellyfish just clog the intake of the cooling water, and then the, sometimes the plant gets shut down, and of course sometimes they have to reduce their power, making a huge economic loss. However, electricity company didn't say anything about this. How many yens of loss, they didn't say anything. They tend to keep these things secret. However, they have to do something, of course. This data shows, and it's all data, but when the many jellyfish, they just come to the plant, over 200 tons per day. Okay? So they have to remove these jellyfish to keep the plant operating. So how to do it for the plant? They have to install the cutting walls, a sort of cutting walls of the aeration in the intake, water intake area, to make the jellyfish afloat. And then they would like to suck the deeper water to the plant. Okay? That's one of the ways. And still they have problems. Lots of jellyfish comes in and clog the screen. So they have to remove the jellyfish from the screen. And then they just install a sort of conveyor to remove the jellyfish from the screen. Also, they have to spend the additional money for this. I will just change slightly the figure. You can imagine how big the jellyfish is. You may go to a Chinese restaurant and you will see a round shape. In Chinese restaurant, they like a round shape, 2 meters in diameter, for example. This jellyfish is such large. Okay? The divers would like to measure the length, compare the divers and this jellyfish. 2 meters in diameter is maximum size. It's just reasonable. And then they cause a lot of problem in East Asian waters. Where do this jellyfish come from? They are coming from this area. The Big Bay system, flanked by Korean Peninsula and mainland of China. And then seasonally, young medusa are released from the pot. And then almost at the same time, the Changjiang River, one of the biggest river, one of the longest river in the world, released a huge amount of fresh water into the East China Sea. And then the young medusa are entrained in this low salinity water mass to transport to offshore. And then there's a Tsushima current from the south, and then to push these young medusa up to the north, and then they finally go into the Japan Sea. And then after this, the transportation goes just at the mercy of the Tsushima current, which just brings the jellyfish towards the north. So we have middle Japan, and in September we go up to a northern island called Hokkaido, and then most of them are transported to the Pacific side, and then they finally transport to the Bozo Peninsula near Tokyo. They have no chance to go back to this homeland, just expatriate. They die, just a one-way trip. And then during transportation, during being transported along the Japanese coast, they caused a lot of problems by entering the huge number of the medusa into the settlement, just like this. And then similar bloom took place for the first time, according to our records, 1920, second one there, 1958, third one is 95, so nearly once per 40 years intervals. It's very rare event in the last century. However, from the turn of this century, they appear, the bloom occurred 2002, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and no bloom, 8, but 9. See? They're almost ended. So the something changed dramatically. And then we have lots of problems. Just I'm showing here this jellyfish carved and burst the net. And then, of course, decreased the fish catch and killing and spoiled the fish, because they sting the fish, and sting also the fishermen. Increase of time and labor to remove medusa from the net. Okay? Increase of capsizing of trawler, so be it. Okay? And then they just catch this big one, and then just bring it up onto the small boat, and then they just lost the boat to capsize. So in 2005, the big boom year, we have more than 100,000 complaints and the records on damage of fisheries, and estimated monetary loss is 300 million euros. That's quite huge. What's the possible causes? Just something happens in the homeland or sitting place. There's a global warming, the temperature is steadily increasing in this area as other places, and eutrophication is just significant. You will see just an exponential increase of phosphorus and nitrogen, but the decrease of silica, causing just a change of the chemical composition or nutritional composition, favoring the flagellate more than compared to diatoms. Diatoms are the major phytoplankton, and flagellate, we do not need any silica for their production. Okay? And then the overfishing is going on, And also, of course, reconstruction is going on. These kind of just mixed and then combined the effect, affect the environment, which makes favorable for jellyfish to increase. So another way of thinking why the jellyfish become more than the ecosystem with fish dominated one to the jellyfish dominated one. Currently, we have many human impact. Okay, and then once the environment is favorable for jellyfish, jellyfish become more and more dominated to press down the kingfish. I call this process as jellyfish spiral. Of course, you may know in economy or economics the deflation spiral. I just steal the same words. I call this phenomenon as jellyfish spiral. Of course, the kingfish just spirally decrease according to my according to my hypothesis. So this condition is already established in Chinese coastal waters. That's why we have regularly occur this jellyfish bloom. In relation to fish catch or fish stocks, stock size, you will see according to the Japanese fish catch statistics, Japan Sea fish catch and the East China Sea fish catch. The peak is just 1960s, I think. Before this, the fish catch was quite high and sound. And then after that, they declined very sharply. And then the jellyfish bloom taking place. During the decreasing phase of the fish catch, showing less fish, less finfish, more jellyfish we have. However, you will see that some years no jellyfish bloom. So we'd like to know in advance. This year could be a bloom year or non-bloom year. That's really important information for fishermen. Now, using a ferry boat between Japan and China, actually using the three ferry routes between Japan and China, we just on board the ship and then keep watching. And then counting the number of jellyfish within the certain water length. Okay? And then the position is recorded with GPS. And then make where the jellyfish is more abundant. I show you the example. This is the cases, the 2009, big bloom year. You will see along this cruise line. This is starting point and ending point. This is the number of jellyfish per 100 square kilometers per 5 minutes. Each column indicates the jellyfish density for 5 minutes. Okay? Of course, the higher the column, the more the jellyfish. This scale is just a logarithmic scale. You will see that the Medusa are distributed widely Chinese and Korean coastal waters. And then the front line is here. They are just about to invade into the Sea of Japan. Uh, 2010, only the small numbers of Medusa are seen near the Qingdao, off the water of Qingdao. Okay? And then this year's event, this is July, the 2 months before, we have quite a number of jellyfish in Chinese pool. So based on this information, we can tell in advance, okay, this is blooming year and this is safe year. We started this monitoring since 2006. 2006, 7, and 9, we had a big bloom year in Japan. And then the average density, reduced density in Yellow Sea is 2 to 3 reducer per 100 square year. And 2008, 10, 11 is no non-bloom year. So the density is 2 to 4 order magnitude than the red curve. What happens this year? It's just this number, a sort of intermediate level. But I just say to the fishermen, oh, this year you have to pay attention. You have to be careful, since they will come, jellyfish will come. By knowing this year is bloom year or not, and then next step, the fishermen, I would like to know when they will come. And then this is the business by the physical oceanographers and the modelers. You will see the particles just mimicking the jellyfish, just change the position according to the date, month and date. Now the set July 29th, August 10th. In September, they go up to the Northern Island, Hokkaido, okay? So the fishermen can know when they will come. They do not know, of course, how many they will come. But when they come, the fishermen can know, depending on these models. It's very important too. Okay, and then, we cannot just destroy these jellyfish before they come to the fishing net. They come, actually. So the last phase of the jellyfish bloom is just a battle between fishermen and jellyfish. Set net cannot move, of course. Already it's set. We have many set net fisheries along Japan. We have large ones and small ones. And the large one is just like this. It's an aerial photo. This leading net just extends to several kilometers into the coast, up to the coast. And then fish migrate here, and then just bump into the leading net and change the direction. And also come, soon also come to this direction. And then there's several chambers of net, which just go in, and then just go into the inner part of the net, and then finally they get harvested. Different directions. So fish comes and then change to the direction, get into the net, and then goes into the inner part of the net, and then finally get harvested. The same is true for jellyfish, right? This is the harvesting net of the jellyfish. Full of jellyfish, no fish, just jellyfish. However, they have to, or fishermen have to remove it to keep the net operating. It's enormous energy they have to take. However, now some modification of the net is designed to exclude the jellyfish from the net. One is, of course, the enlargement of the mesh size. net mesh size, where the jellyfish is clustered. And another one is the bypass net. Bypass net, the fish just go through, swim through. However, the big jellyfish are trapped and then finally removed into removed to the outside. So we call this net as a bypass net. And then finally, we have a partition net, which separate the fish from, we separate the jellyfish from the fish, and then remove outside the net. So by using this net, the fishermen appreciate the good fish catch. However, the fishermen have to spend quite a large amount of the money for this type of the modification of the net. It cost 50 to 100,000 euros for this investment. Once these nets are introduced and used, fishermen just appreciate the good fish catch, just like this. And then by doing the prediction, early prediction, this year is good, the blue year or not, and then also the trajectory of the jellyfish by modeling, and also the modification of the net, that we can just reduce the damage in 2009, less than 10 billion euros. Of course, we have more damage in the 2005. So now we just reduced the damage by developing the management or by developing some countermeasures. Finally, I will just conclude that some good things for the jellyfish. They are edible. Not all jellyfish are edible, but this Nemopilema, the giant jellyfish, is a kind of edible jellyfish. So they are just harvested, dissected, bell and the oral arms, and then clean them and then soak into salt and alum. Salt remove the water from the jet body, and then alum just change the protein, this gelatinous form, to a crunchy. So processed jellyfish is crunchy, not jelly. and also, of course, before cooked in many varieties. And then we Asian people, Japanese people, Korean people, but majority of course, the Chinese people appreciate the jellyfish as just a cuisine. So I will just conclude my talk. The jellyfish population are increasing globally. Yeah. In Japan and also the Northern Adriatic Sea, particularly in waters under significant human impact. And East Asian sea is particularly two species, Aurelia albita and Nemopilema nominae, the giant jellyfish. Bloom of jellyfish impose considerable socio-economic hardship to fisheries. Aquaculture, I didn't tell detail about the aquaculture and the power plant operation and tourism. Tourism is not so important in Asian countries, but here, in the Mediterranean Sea is very important. Again, I didn't explain in detail about the tourism. Bloom appeared to be difficult, if not impossible, to eradicate. Of course, it's impossible to eradicate the jellyfish itself. But maybe we can control some. The above mentioned industries fisheries or something like that, have to develop management strategies that will enable them to successfully coexist in more jellyfish in the sea. We have to just harmonically live with more jellyfish in the future. However, the jellyfish is edible, the abundant, but in the seas, lots of jellyfish is not healthy condition. Seas with lots of finfish is just as a healthy condition. So we would like to keep the healthy ocean to sustain more fish, not jellyfish. Thank you.
Vprašanja zdaj profesorju Šinu, koga kaj zanima v zvezi s tem, kar je question.
Does this jellyfish have good nutritional values?
Yes. You,
is it good for our body?
Well, it's a sort of the diet food. Yeah, it does not contain many calories, lots of volume, okay? Mm-hmm. And the taste itself quite plain, but no taste. So you have to cook with oils and the soy sauce or some other things. Well, yes, I should say first, the jellyfish is the healthy food.
And not many calories, right?
Not many calories. Yeah, diet food. And some the Chinese the people say that some medicinal effect. Yeah, however, it's very difficult to prove it is really effective for some disease. Yeah. So, but anyway, the having or eating the jellyfish is a sort of traditional culture. In China, Korea, and Japan, yeah, and enjoy the crunchy the texture and plain taste of the jellyfish. Not your choices, I guess.
Any other questions, Alinka?
I saw some modeling results, and yes. I'm interested. How many scientists are working on this?
By McLean. The three scientists are involved, physical oceanographer and modelers, and then one more biological oriented scientist. Yeah, these are the results from the team effect by three scientists.
Three scientists?
Yeah, three scientists.
They spend more on nets and mechanical solutions than on scientific So I understand that people try to solve and invest more money in solving this with mechanical solutions and other solutions than in studying this problem.
Yeah, mechanical solution is just one way of just slicing up the medusae, mm-hmm. Right? The thinking of the burst volume of the sea, yeah, mechanical way is not a good way to remove the jellyfish. Well, so we can just predict when. Well, first they will come in abundance, and when they will come, and then the fishermen may know. Fishermen may know in advance what kind of countermeasure they can make. If the jellyfish is much more abundant. Then the fishermen can control. Maybe they have to accept the fishing moratorium, I think.
Yeah. But I understood, if I understood her correctly, she also contrasted money invested into science towards money invested for developing new nets, because really big money went into set nets to modify
them. Oh, I see. Uh-huh. However, of course the scientists help to develop this kind of technique. And then the fishermen just feel profitable to introduce the new technique. Actually, they can just keep operating the fisheries, even the many jellyfish come. If they do not use such kind of new technique, maybe their nets are just completely torn down. Yeah. So I think our science and our investment to protect this jellyfish damage is, I think, successful. The fishermen are happy to introduce this technique.
Andrea,
you have another question? Yes, more biological. So the rounding area or spawning area is then restricted between China and Japan. And then they spread from these rounding areas, right? So do you have any idea what constrained the polyps or reproduction in that area?
Yeah, I told you that migrating jellyfish to a Japanese quarters is just expatriate, just one way. They have no chance to go back. However, in Chinese coastal waters, as I told you, that area is just a big bay system. So the mother population remain in that area. And then the life cycle is just a cycle. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they did not just vanish away. Yeah. So the certain population are always kept in the Chinese and Korean waters. And then some population just spilled out from that area, just invade to the Japanese waters.
Another question.
Yeah.
So you how is with this problem of tuberculosis in other parts of the world, if you could say generally, and the other, do you see some prediction also in
the Mediterranean
Sea to have this problem?
Or? Well, there's no good drug to, no medicine, you know, good medicine to cure this problem, to disease, I should say. Yeah, well, as I told you, the causes to increase the jellyfish is more or less related with our human activities. The global warming, eutrophication, marine construction, deoxygenation, you know, so maybe we have to reduce our activity, our human activity. And also the most important thing is just to keep the fish stock at a certain good level. That means fisheries managed, fish managed, fisheries managed is very important. If the fish stock is always healthy and then abundant in the sea, they may just eat the jellyfish. So fish and jellyfish just compete each other. But we take selectively remove the fish out from the sea, so the jellyfish are happy. If the fish stock are healthy, I think the jellyfish some difficulty to find, to grow their populations. So I think first we have to reduce our activity, and then particularly among this, the fishing management is very important to keep a certain amount of fish stock in the sea. And do I answer your question? You may have two questions.
Yeah, well, one was just in general, if also in some other country they had this problem, if you know a real problem, they were dealing with it. And
there's no countries who really succeeded with just control the jellyfish rule. Yeah, there's no countries which succeeded. Maybe Japan is a leading country to develop this technique. Yeah. But we cannot reduce the jellyfish to itself. We just predict, we just show in advance to the fishermen that this year's jellyfish is just like this. How do you do for this for this event? I mean, for the coming large number of the jellyfish this year. So it's not the real solution, but the science and our developed technique may help the fishing to reduce the damage by jellyfish. Yes.
Do you perhaps have reliable information about overfishing? Because Greenpeace is talking that we already fished out of the oceans about 80% of fish supply.
Yeah, right.
What are your numbers?
Well, I know that we over-harvested many, many products of the world. So I think the, I say that the jellyfish program become globally, they are globally extended. And then that is the result that the jellyfish, sorry, the fish stock get decreased, mainly by the fisheries, our act. So overfishing program, of course, just leading to the more jellyfish-dominated society, to more jelly-dominated ecosystem in the ocean. We have to avoid such kind of
things. But would you say that 80%, like Greenpeace says, it's too large number?
As far as I know, that 80% of the world area over-harvested. Some area is not so over-harvested. Yeah, particularly the coastal waters, easy to go, and then the fish stock are over-harvested.
But not globally, you wouldn't say that's the correct
number. Well, I cannot say about the 80%.
Okay,
is correct or not, yeah.
Any more questions? No questions?
Dobro, pol bi se še jaz v imenu Fakultete za management, zahvalil profesor Šinu, thank you profesor Šin in the name of the Faculty of Management of University of Primorska. Zahvalil bi se Morski biološki postaji, ki v bistvu sodelovanju s katero smo to predavanje pripeljali na Fakulteto za management in mogoče dodal samo eno stvar, če nas mogoče zanima, zakaj v bistvu je prišlo do tega sodelovanja, ki mogoče, bodo rekel, zelo mogoče to ne spada pod prvi Fakultete za management, ki se pa navezal na temo, ki jo je profesor Šin dal v svojem v predavanju. Verjetno ste videli, ko je bila ocena tam, da je bila škoda okoli 300 milijonov evrov ocenjena zaradi teh pač problemov v ribištvu. V sodelovanju z Morsko biološko postajo smo tudi mi na Fakulteti za management razvili model, bomo rekli, razvoja teh meduz in kasneje smo probali to povezati tudi z ekonomskim vplivom, tako da tle je bila, to je tudi ena izmed mnogih stvari, ki smo jih probali zdaj v sodelovanju skupaj narediti. Seveda se pri nas to ni pokazalo, ribištvo v naši državi še nima tako velikega tržnega deleža, da bi v bistvu bila ta razlika zelo očitna, tako kot se je videlo na Japonskem. Smo pa prišli do tega, da so bili določeni vplivi in v bistvu se trudimo naprej. Zdaj smo se povezali tudi z ribiči, z podatki, z ribičem iz Trsta, tako da bomo probali tudi na našem področju. Če sem prav razumel eno vprašanje, bo tudi kako na nas to vpliva, ne? Delno kako na naše, ja, vpliva tudi na naše ribiče in to je tudi pri nas bilo. Tako da, če vas bo zanimalo še kaj več, mogoče tem lahko sedemo, imamo modele, bomo rekli, modele rasti teh medu smo razvili, Morska biološka postaja, potem z njimi, sodelovanju z njimi. Naredili smo pa tudi že modeli vpliva na ekonomijo pri nas, ampak potem kaj več mogoče drugič. Jaz bi se še enkrat sem lepo zahvalil za to, da ste prišli, da se bomo še daj v naših prostorih s takimi zanimivimi predavanji. Najlepša hvala vsem. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.